there! I'm so happy to see you. Welcome back to Mrs. Holsen's Neighborhood. Ruff and I have been looking at old pictures today.
He was such a cute little puppy.
Yeah, you were littler. It's fun to go back and remember things. And to look at pictures from old times, too, and see how things have changed. Has anything changed in your neighborhood since you were little? It's really kind of cool. Sometimes it's so different, it's Greek to me. Do you know what that expression means? That expression means that something is so different that it might as well be written in a language that you can't read. Isn't that interesting? Let's stand up for warm-ups! It's Crazy Eights Week! You ready? 8-7-6-5-4-3-2-1 8-7-6-5-4-3-2-1 8-7-6-5-4-3-2-1 8-7-6-5-4-3-2-1 7-6-5-4-3-2-1 7-6-5-4-3-2-1 7-6-5-4-3-2-1 7-6-5-4-3-2-1
6-5-4-3-2-1 6-5-4-3-2-1 6-5-4-3-2-1 6-5-4-3-2-1
5-4-3-2-1 5-4-3-2-1 5-4-3-2-1 5-4-3-2-1 4-3-2-1 4-3-2-1 4-3-2-1 4-3-2-1
3-2-1 3-2-1 3-2-1 3-2-1 2-1 2-1 2-1 2-1
1-1-1-1 0. Are you ready for some tongue twisters? Let's stretch our faces out. Chew up some imaginary gum. Chew it over in one cheek. Chew it in the other cheek. Chew it in the front of your mouth. Chew it in the back of your mouth, but don't swallow it. And then stretch your mouth out wide. And squish it out. Let's take a deep breath. And here we go. Our first tongue twister is a proper copper coffee pot. A proper copper coffee pot. A proper copper coffee pot. Oh, that's tricky. A proper copper coffee pot.
Coffee pot, a proper coffee pot, a proper coffee pot.
A proper copper coffee pot, a proper copper coffee pot, a proper coffee coffer pot.
Good job. The next one comes from our friend Chloe. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Should we try it twice in a row? Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap.
Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap.
Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap. Silver slippery soap.
Ooh, tricky one, Chloe. Thank you. The next one comes from our friend Elizabeth. Here we go. Pam picks pineapple peanut butter. Pam picks pineapple peanut butter? Pam picks pineapple peanut butter! Pam picks pineapple... Oh no, I totally messed that up. Pam picks pineapple peanut butter.
Pam picks pineapple peanut butter. Pam picks pineapple peanut butter. Pam picks pineapple peanut butter.
Oh my goodness, Elizabeth. That's a tricky one, too. Here's one that I thought of when I was out working in the yard. Rory's rake rarely rakes really right. Rory's rake rarely rakes really right. Rory's rake really... Oh no. Rory's rake rarely rakes really right. Huh. That's a tricky one, too. Thought we'd bring back a couple classics today. So our next tongue twister is one that I remember from when I was a child, thinking back to old times. Rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Good job, Ruff. Rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Should we do it fast? Rubber baby buggy bumpers, rubber baby buggy bumpers, rubber baby buggy bumpers, rubber baby buggy bumpers. Oh, that was great.
We gotta end with the best one.
I know, Ruff. Toy boat. Toy boat, toy boat. Toy boat, toy boat, toy boat. Toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat. Toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat, toy boat. Hey, that was pretty great. Thanks for doing tongue twisters today. It's Pokemon time. It's Pokemon time. It's Pokemon time. Our hints today were that Ruff and I were looking at old pictures and talking about the past. Today, we are thinking about history. So that means our Pokemon might just be legendary. That's right. Today's Pokemon is Dialga. A Pokemon spoken of in legend. It is said that time began moving when Dialga was born. Today, let's see, we did warm-ups, right? Here we are at Pokemon time, and we are going to explore the beginnings of theater. We're going back in time. For our extra game, remember, you can sign up to come play with me online. You can just scan this code or check Schoology or Seesaw or the Specialist Newsletter, and you can sign right up for Drama Game Time. I'd love to play with you online. Speaking of playing, it's my favorite time. It's playtime. Ruff! You ready? Today, we are going to go back in time to the beginnings of theater.
Ruff, how are we gonna get there?
You don't know either? Well, we might need to do some time travel. So luckily, I have a TARDIS handy. See? It's great to have a TARDIS handy when you wanna go learn some theater history. You ready, gang? We're gonna travel through time and relative dimensions in space back to ancient Greece. Let's check this out. Oh yeah, it's bigger on the inside. Wow, that was a wild ride. I wonder if we made it. Hey, we're all wearing togas. You guys, I think we made it. I think we're in ancient Greece. Let's go find some theaters. Wow, so this is ancient Greece. If you didn't know, Greece is a country in Europe on the Mediterranean Sea, so it is lovely and warm here. It's 532 BC. We've gone back over 2,500 years.
Ruff, theater is old!
Yes, it is. Hey, no comments, tomato. So humans have been telling each other stories for a long, long time. In Greece, the first use of theaters was to play music and to dance in honor of their gods. The songs were sung by a group of people called a chorus, and the songs were stories about the Greek gods. After a while, the chorus began to act out some of the stories, and then Greek playwrights began to write more and more stories for the chorus to perform.
Ruff, I love stories!
So do we. And so did the Greeks. There would often be 15,000 people at their plays, and they got really competitive about which town could write the best plays. And the winners were respected like Olympic athletes. That's another great Greek tradition.
What did the theaters look like?
Well, with crowds that big and a climate this warm, they built their theaters outside, right into the side of the hill. The theatron, the seeing place, right? We remember learning that, is where the audience would sit, and it was shaped kind of like a big half circle. The stage had a big circle in the middle called the orchestra. What? You're right, Tomato. In our time and place, orchestras are a group of people who play stringed instruments. But the orchestra in a Greek theater was a place, and that is where the chorus sang and danced. I guess that word has something to do with a place for music. The theatron, by the way, where the audience sat, was built so that everybody in the audience could hear even a whisper from on stage. It was really great engineering. And you could even go there in modern times and stand on the stage and whisper, and people way up the hill could hear you. That's amazing. Speaking of engineering, the Greeks built some really cool machines to help tell those stories. The stage had a building on it called the Scene House, where the actors could change their costumes and enter and exit, and sometimes they would decorate it like a backdrop. There was a big crane up on top of the scene, and they called it the God Machine, because they would use that so a character could pretend to come down from the sky. They also had a machine that made thunder noises, because the most important god in Greek mythology was Zeus, the god of thunder. And if you've ever seen Hercules, you might remember him. He was kind of a big deal. In ancient Greek times, all the actors were men. What? I know, right? I couldn't be an actor if I lived in ancient Greece. Not very fair. But since they were all men, there were still women characters in the stories, so the men dressed up as women sometimes. It was normal. No big deal. One of the most famous actors was named Thespis. He was kind of that rock star of ancient Greece. And that, by the way, is why actors are sometimes called thespians today. The actors in Greek theater wore masks, partly so those 15,000 people up there in the theatron could tell who was who from way up the hill. But also, they helped amplify their voices. Most of them were made out of plaster and painted linen cloth, so they didn't actually last. We don't have them anymore, but we have sculptures that were copies of what they looked like, and stone lasts. Those we have. Check these out. Do you think you could make your own? Check the comments. I'll post a link to a template for you. Ruff! So what were the plays about? Well, sometimes they were stories about the gods, but in Greece they wrote three main kinds of plays. They wrote tragedies, which taught a lesson and always had a sad ending, very serious plays. They wrote comedies. Comedies were always really funny. And then the satyr plays, or the satires, made fun of real people and events. They were kind of like those comedy shows that grown-ups watch now. The word tragedy, by the way, comes from a Greek expression that means goat song. So how about that, Tomato? Goats have always been important in theater. By the way, the drama masks that we use to represent theater, they come from tragedy and comedy. You see how one is always frowning or crying and the other one is always smiling? There it is. Now once, way in my way back time, when I was in college, I went to visit the Acropolis in Greece, where there's a great big theater. Here's a little picture of me there. So here's your Bobcat challenge. Could you make a Greek theater mask or two? Maybe you could put together a play that was very serious and tragic, or a play that was very funny, or a play about some Greek gods. Do a little research online. There's a lot to find out about that culture. And hey, time travel is really fun. You can learn a lot of things about the past by doing a little research and looking around. Ask the people in your life who were there back when. See what they can tell you, and see if you can look at some old photos or videos. Whatever you do, make sure that you remember to play. See you next week.